So without further ado, I'm going to introduce a man that doesn't need much of an introduction whatsoever. He's been an amazing man to work with as we've been working with the Smart City project here with Cisco, Sprint, and many others. So without further ado, Mayor Sly James.
Well, good morning. I've got on my red cap here, my Monarch's cap, because today is Red Thursday. It's Kansas City Chiefs kicked the Broncos' butt tonight. So I had to wear it. Had something on my feet, red socks, so I'm kind of like head to toe red, but some blue in the middle for the Royals. I want to welcome you all here to Tech Week in Kansas City. We are extremely honored to be hosting this conference, and we're absolutely thrilled to welcome you here and to welcome all of you and share with you the exciting tech and innovation projects that we have working and going on in our community. We're currently implementing the largest smart city infrastructure in North America, and that's going to bring features like interactive kiosks, mobile applications, sensory technology, smart street lighting, et cetera, to Kansas City, and it'll be installed on the streetcar spine in downtown. This framework is really going to help our government and our city to become much smarter and more efficient. We've also launched a digital roadmap for the city, which is a living and breathing document designed to grow and bend as the city's digital future evolves. This roadmap is going to establish and has established new ways for us to collect information and data, to analyze that data, to leverage resources across city departments, and to share information all for the advantage of the city. We're now a national open data center and a leader in that area. We provide greater online access to critical data about city operations than most other cities in the entire world. Launch KC, another of our great programs, is awarding 10 $50,000 grants to KC startup companies and startup companies generally, continuing their commitment to fueling the entrepreneurial spirit of this city. The Sprint Accelerator serves as a cornerstone of our city's tech community. It serves as a place where some of our city's most innovative thinkers can come together and gain access to both business development and mentorship opportunities. When Google Fiber first launched here in 2012, and I just want to say this because I never get tired of saying it, we were the first ones out of 1,100. And we didn't have to get a bunch of people and lay down in the snow and spell out Google so that we could be seen by satellites. We didn't change the name of the city. None of those things. We just simply did what we did, which was work together in order to present the best possible application and make it easy for Google to come in and do their thing. But when they came here in 2012, our local entrepreneurs were strengthened. They were empowered, and the city was really flooded with new waves of tech talent from around the country. We kind of got on the map in a lot of people's minds there, although we had always been on the map. People just didn't know about it. As a result, Startup Village has organically grown into a real village where small businesses operate out of homes connected to Google Fiber. And the interesting thing about that is that Startup Village is really a village that straddles a state line, so it incorporates both Kansas City, Missouri, and Kansas City, Kansas. One of those things where we've learned that blurring the lines that separate us really does make a lot of sense, particularly when we're talking about innovation, because innovation really knows no lines. We've made some huge strides locally in advancing technology and innovation, and we take a great deal of pride in that. And I can safely say that we're either on the forefront or on a par with other cities around the rest of the world when it comes to tech. But we have a ton of work to do. We have a lot of work to do both here and in other places around the world, because while we're all making significant advances, there are many people who are simply being left behind and left out. If I had to guess, most of you have been sitting in this audience right now, and a lot of you have probably seen at least one tweet since I've been here talking. I think your tweet probably looks something like or reads something like, listening to the handsome, witty, charming, well-dressed, awesome at Mayor Sly James inspire the hashtag TechweekKC crowd today. That bow tie, though, you know? Might be a little more than 40 characters, but you kind of get my point. Most of us are so used to sharing every bit of information, every moment on social media that we don't even think about it. It's just becoming natural. You receive a promotion at work, you got to tweet it. You get engaged to the love of your life, it's not official until it's on Facebook. And that's really true because once you put it on Facebook, you can't back out. You finally get your first sip of pumpkin latte for the season. Well, you either have to do an Instagram or a Snapchat on that. And if you're like me, you don't feel right if you leave your phone or phones. In my case, I don't want a Hillary moment. I have two at home. So those of us in this room and our contemporaries are so used to being in constant contact, constantly connected to the internet, to share good news, to share bad news, to keep in touch with families and friends, to communicate on all sorts of different levels, find answers to questions. Most of us are well positioned to provide that same level of connectivity to our immediate family members and friends. So it's hard for people with financial means or familiarity with the network and the benefits of it to really imagine what it's like not having that connectivity. It's even harder to imagine someone not having access to the internet at all or having never used a computer or owning a smartphone in this day and age. Now, I, as a mature gentleman, understand how that was. I've grown into it. When I went to law school in Syracuse, I didn't even have a phone for a year. Computers were out of the question. That was back in the days when you had a portable phone that came in a shoebox and you carried it around proudly so that everybody knew that you were on the cutting edge. You had a box phone, okay? People don't even have that sometimes anymore. And I may be preaching to the choir here a little bit, but I'm going to go ahead and preach about it a little bit because here in Kansas City, lack of access to the digital network and lack of digital literacy are real issues. They affect real people and they have real outcomes, and we're trying to overcome that. I want to be very upfront and thank Google for really crystallizing that digital divide for us. They had a tremendous original marketing plan, ingenious really. They basically managed to get parts of the city called fiberhoods, parts or whole parts of neighborhoods, to compete against each other, to put down money and reserve a place for a product that they had never heard of or seen before. And they did it. But when enough people in those neighborhoods did that and they reached their goal in terms of percentage of people signing up, some areas turned green, which means they had succeeded. Other areas were red, which means they hadn't. So in our city, following the traditional and typical racial divide, those on the affluent side of that divide turned green. Those on the non-affluent side, the poorer side, were red. Those on the affluent side were mostly white, middle class, upper middle class. Those on the other side were not. So we were able to see crystal clear where the line of the divide was. So when they did that, they did a little research too, and they learned that from the lay of the land, they decided how they could best deploy the fiber network in Kansas City and conducted a survey and a study of how our residents in the city use the internet and for what purposes and in what neighborhoods and across what demographics. And their findings were a little bit concerning, to say the least. They found that 17% of Kansas Cityans didn't use the internet at all. Now, of that 17%, 44% were 65 or older, 46% were African American, 42% made less than $25,000 a year, and 64% had only a high school level education or less. Now, this isn't ancient history. This is 2012. Now, given those statistics, it's pretty clear which of the demographics in our community are being left behind. Google actually mapped that out for us. So the neighborhoods west of Truce went green, neighborhoods east of Truce went red. Those neighborhoods were red because people either couldn't afford it or didn't have any use for it, didn't see the value in it, weren't using it as part of their day-to-day life. Back in 2012, if I didn't have both of my phones, a laptop, and an iPad in constant reach, I felt like I was naked and needed to do something about it because it was that crucial to what we did every day. Not for them. For those of you not from Kansas City, I want to just tell you that Truce is the traditional racial and socioeconomic dividing line, and the differences between the two sides was absolutely stark. So Google highlighted that for us, and the neediest of our residents were being left out and left further and further behind on this essential need. It's no longer a luxury to be connected. It is absolutely a necessity. So they also found that 25% of Kansas City residents did not have broadband at home. Faster internet speeds allow people to efficiently conduct more meaningful activities online than we often take for granted, and like researching for educational purposes, paying our bills online, searching for job opportunities, or even accessing online data from the city and that we provide. But having that kind of speed is invaluable for all sorts of things that people want and need to do every day. So to expect those folks to be able to succeed in an increasingly technological world when they're not even connected to that technological world was asking too much. To understand the impact of that disconnectivity on the economy of the city was something that we had to put our minds to and to try to resolve. Another important component was something near and dear to my heart, the education of our children. Currently, 70% of the children in Kansas City do not have access to the internet at home. Think about that. You go to school, and if you're in a district, and some of our districts have been very good about giving people tablets or laptops, giving kids those tools, and then you get home and you can't connect, it's a nice paperweight. What do? You go to the library where we have connectivity, perhaps. Some people even go to grocery stores where they have connectivity. 70% is unacceptable, totally unacceptable. So now more than ever, kids are utilizing the internet and software to learn and explore new ideas and submit assignments. But even more crucial than that, this year with the testing that children go through in schools, they've gone to keyboards and using computers. So if you're not able to use computers and keyboard and access the internet anytime you want, all the time that you want, you are automatically going to be in a deficient and trailing position to those who use it all the time. So you won't even have the ability to compete on an even playing field when you're taking the tests at school. Parents use the internet to monitor their kids' progression and to communicate with teachers. But if you're not connected, how do you do that? Pick up the phone, I guess. So how can we expect these kids, how can we expect them to excel if they're not able to access and use the internet in order to, the same as other classmates in other more affluent parts of the city, how do we expect them to compete worldwide when they can't compete across Truce Avenue? How do we expect kids to have the skills and the basic understandings to prepare them to become the workforce of this economy and the economy of this state and the economy of this country, where tech jobs are growing and other jobs are shrinking, if they don't have the basic skills and literacy to do it? So we've come up with some city and local partners, and we're taking steps to rectify that problem here in Kansas City, and we're proud of the progress that we're making, but make no mistake about it, we're not even close to being finished. And we won't be finished until every child in this city, and hopefully in this state and in this country, has the ability to access the internet, has the ability to receive a world-class education, regardless of race, regardless of socioeconomics, regardless of the zip codes that they live in. Because if we do not do this, everything else will be retarded. If we cannot supply all of you out here starting businesses that will be reliant on technologically savvy workforce with those people, what are you going to do? Your growth will be retarded, and you may not be able to succeed to the level that you want, which means fewer jobs, which means a worsening economy. We have to do this. So we've gotten together with some private companies and nonprofits, been working together to foster digital inclusion in a variety of ways. Our digital inclusion partners working to narrow the digital divide here in Kansas City by offering services like digital literacy classes, free Wi-Fi and access to computers in our libraries, training on how to build mesh networks, opportunities to purchase low-cost discounted computers and equipment. And just last week, we became an e-steward enterprise, which certified and committed itself to doing what we've already been doing, which is to safely and purposely and responsibly repurpose our computer equipment from the city and put it to good use in the private sector and in people's homes. Our hope is that we enlist some of our corporate citizens in this effort. Becoming certified is easy, and it's responsible, and it's purposeful. And with my knowledge and connection with our corporate sponsors and citizens, that's not going to be a problem. They've already started signing up. We're also partnering with the Surplus Exchange, Connecting for Good, and other nonprofits to make available to our residents refurbished city computer equipment and Google Fiber-connected computer labs in community centers and elsewhere across the city. And one of our other most recent wins is the city, our Full Employment Council, Surplus Exchange, Connecting for Good, and our other partner organizations recently launched Digital Scholars as an on-job training program that will advance many of our digital inclusion goals. This program will use state funds to provide paid on-the-job training to approximately 30 residents ages 16 to 24, and then we'll start over and do it again. It'll teach program participants to wipe hard drives, refurbish community, wire computer labs, and do more. Digital scholars will also be trained to work on social media, website development, program design, game development, and audiovisual production. It'll provide labor to participating nonprofit organizations to increase their digital inclusion efforts. And as a result, more people will be trained for technology-related jobs in this city. Speaking of tech hiring, the city's also working locally to get more people trained in tech jobs. We're working with the Full Employment Council again in our local workforce development organizations to train people on an accelerated basis for positions in tech. Whether it's coding, web or software development, sales or marketing specific to tech, we're working with local companies to provide on-the-job training with job-specific training curriculums to provide people with the exact types of skills that are needed for those jobs. We're making the connection between the training you get and the job that you take, and we're doing it in such a way that we entice people to come to the training, because if they do, they automatically get the job at the end. That's the type of connectivity on a personal, people basis that leads to better connectivity on a digital basis. But as you know, digital divide and tech hire gaps, not specific, certainly not limited to Kansas City, and people are struggling on how to address these issues across the country and, in fact, across the world. In 2013, an American Community Survey found that less than half of the households headed by someone who didn't graduate high school had a home internet connection, compared to over 90% of the households that were headed by college graduates. Black and Hispanic households were at 16 and 11 percentage points respectively less likely to have an internet connection than white households. Now, here's the problem that I see with that divide. Why do we, in this increasingly complicated and very interesting world where innovation is sought after like gold, why would we want to have 16 and 11 percent of our various populations on the sideline? When if all were participating, the synergy would be greater. The innovation and the rate of innovation would be greater. We need everybody pulling this train, not just some. Native American households trail everybody by 19%, but what's new about that? You talk about a forgotten, invisible population in this country. It's Native Americans. So although digital inclusion is certainly good there, man, it'd be nice just to have some social inclusion with Native Americans, because we're not doing a very good job on any of those scales. In some countries, broadband still costs 10% or more of the average monthly income of the person who wants to use it. That's out of range for most people when you really think about it. The good news is this is where all of you capable and crafty people come in. People smarter than me, you know what you're doing. I'm faking it. So as tech leaders, and as good citizens, and as people who care about going forward in this country in a way that benefits us all, going to ask you to shoulder the responsibility to this society to use your talents to help close this gap and to educate those folks who are being left behind. There is no downside to that. None. The old adage goes, to whom much is given, much is expected, and frankly, that is real. We all know people who are jerks and have never been nice to anybody, and what do we say? They'll get theirs. And it's true, because you can't go through life being a turkey without somebody wanting to put you on the table at Thanksgiving. But we also know that the opposite is true, where people with good hearts go out of their way to do good things for people. It comes back to them in ways that they can't expect, but in ways that bless them in some other way. Use your talents and ideas to make a real difference for your community. Do not allow yourselves to fall into the trap that we're currently in, where a small sliver of the population controls 90% of the wealth and the rest of us kind of struggle to do anything. Use your common sense, use your abilities, your talents, and your skills to make this a better place. And that first and foremost means including all of us, including everyone in the goals and the tasks. Think of your next big innovation in terms of not just economic impact, but in terms of social impact and what you can do to help those who are disadvantaged. Will your next step and your next step, are they gonna help those who are unemployed and living in poverty? Maybe not. But maybe the next one after that will. Maybe at some point, if you think about it, you'll be able to find some way to help us break the cycle of poverty, the cycles of violence, all of those things in this country that plague us and make us a little less than what we really can and should be. So will your next software take language barriers, illiteracy, and disability into consideration? Hope so. Think of ways that you can develop a mechanism for ensuring smartphones, tablets, computers, internet access are more affordable, with adequate levels of functionability and for the use of citizens. Work with local governments and elected leaders to identify barriers to connectivity and create low-cost tech solutions to developing that infrastructure that is critical to promote the dismantling of the digital divide and promote local content hosting. Become the founders of the next Khan Academy or Coder Girl or Coursera. Serve on the mayoral task forces aimed at narrowing the digital divide and providing job and educational opportunities. Offer your services to your city towards participation in national initiatives sort like Connect Home or Tech Hire or similar programs in your own hometowns. Provide on-the-job training and apprenticeships to your companies. Volunteer at local nonprofits that teach coding or digital literacy. You have a unique set of skills. That's why you're here. You have a unique opportunity to use those skills and the knowledge that you have worked your life to build to do something that will help this entire society and yourselves in the process. I hope you'll step up to that challenge. And if you can't do any of those other things, do me one last favor. Go to a school, volunteer to read with a child 1 hour a week, so that they will be able to read proficiently by third grade and hopefully grow into the next you. But whatever you do, and whatever your product, whatever your goal, remember that there are a lot of people who are never going to be able to buy it unless something changes, or won't be able to access it unless they learn something or have access to the internet. In short, the world is in your hands. Don't fumble the ball. Thank you very much. I've enjoyed being here. Thank you very much. Go Chiefs. Thanks, man.
The chief, sir.
Yeah, all right.
Wow. I don't know about you, but I'm always left inspired listening to that man. You know, Kansas City is very, very, very lucky to have that man as a visionary leader that we have.